Good Wednesday evening, Broken Bow First. Glad to join us for our online service tonight. We're excited to be a part of that and glad you're a part of it as well. We've got some breaking news to share with you this evening. And we welcomed our panel discussion here this evening as well. All of our staff pastors will be contributing something in our conversation tonight. So we're glad that you're going to be a part of that with us this evening. Starting Friday, May the 1st, we are in phase one of President Trump's recommendations for reopening our communities, reopening our businesses, and our churches. Phase two will begin Sunday, May 17th. And that is the date that we have chosen to come back together and have services as a church again. So that's May 17th. That's the Sunday after Mother's Day. May 17th at 10:30 Sunday morning. Woohoo! Aren't you excited? Yes. We've got a letter going out to each and every one of you this week detailing some guidelines for our coming back together and our reopening. Please be on the lookout for that. If you have any questions when you read that, please feel free to call the church office and talk to any of our staff pastors concerning that letter, any questions you may have about that. We're going to do some discussion tonight. Our pastors can contribute some answers and maybe answer some of your questions that you've probably come up with over the last 6 or 7 weeks. So welcome all of our staff pastors tonight and welcome you this evening as well. I want to ask you, what have you missed the most during this time of 6 or 7 weeks? It'll be about 8 weeks or 9 weeks by the time we come back together again, but what have you missed the most during this quarantine time?
I think one of the things we miss the most is worshiping together.
Same. Yeah, that's a big one.
Yeah.
I miss the kids, of course, but I also miss seeing just the normal faces coming through the door every week.
Yeah.
Miss the people.
Tyler, what have you missed?
I've definitely missed my students more than anything. It's one thing to connect with them over social media, and that's fun, and we love doing that, keeping them connected throughout the week, but it's just something different about meeting together with them and seeing their face and just hearing about their week and their day from a one-on-one standpoint.
Yeah. It's been a difficult time. I've lost track of days during all this. Lose track of a Sunday or a Wednesday, that kind of thing. The schedule just seems to run all together, and I've found myself wondering what to do on Sundays and Wednesdays, because I'm always at church on those days, and I've just found myself wondering what to do, a little bit lost at home in those kind of situations. But we have missed you more than anything else. That has been our primary concern through this, our connection, and staying connected and relating to you, and we can't wait to get back together again. Well, we know what you've missed the most. That's obviously our people. What have you learned during this time? If all we've learned how to do is online services, we've missed a great opportunity. So what have you learned during this quarantine time?
Well, we definitely learned how to do some editing and videoing.
Yes.
But I think we've also learned church just isn't the four walls that we're sitting in, how to be church outside of the community as well. I know I just went to Walmart and just walked up and down the aisles and said hi to people. That was a big deal to people this week. So I think learning how to be the church outside was definitely a big learning curve for everybody, this, including the people out here.
Yeah. Emily, what have you learned?
I don't know if it's something new, but it's just something that's come back to my memory, is just not taking for granted real relationships. A lot of times we love the internet. We love that we've been able to use the internet during this time, but not, hopefully this shows us that real relationships can't be substituted by online relationships. It's not the same. It's not the same as being in a room. It's not the same as worshiping together. It's just not the same. It's a great tool, but I hope that we don't forfeit real relationships just to be online.
That's good. What you guys?
Well, in a more practical standpoint, I think a lot of us have learned how to cook a lot of our own meals during this time. I like to eat out a lot, so that's been substituted by kind of doing some of our own learning. We've all learned to do so many things, video editing, one of them, just staying connected, trying to find fresh ideas. For the youth, we really weren't doing any kind of online service or anything like that, just like everybody else, so trying to find something that would keep them engaged too, and just get some feedback from them on what they like, what's keeping them engaged.
Yeah. Pastor?
Another thing that I think it's really important, I have heard people say that they have learned how to pray together at home.
Oh, wow. That's great.
How to worship God at home. And sometimes they don't know even how to pray. Unless they're at church.
Mm-hmm.
But they have mentioned that they're learning how to read the Bible with their kids and pray with their kids.
Yeah.
That's another good thing.
That's a good thing. It's a bad thing, too, that they don't know that already, but it's a good thing that they are learning that process. We've definitely, in this quarantine time, have grown closer as families. We've spent more time with our families now than we have any other time, probably, during this time.
Yeah, so what I was going to say is I just hope that during this time it's brought families together.
Yes.
That we're not so caught up in going and doing so much as remembering what's really important in our own homes and worshiping God in our own homes.
Yes.
And bringing that family unit together.
Yes. It's been a difficult time. It's been a trying time, probably a stretching time for all of us as we've done life different. Life has been different for all of us, I think. And so we've all learned some things, probably not only about how to maneuver through this, but how to just live life a little bit differently. Probably learned how to set our priorities a little differently as well. Makes us value our family more. And I know Kim and I have spent a lot of time together, and feel like I value her more and her contribution to our family, and so we've grown in that aspect, I think. We have definitely grown in learning how to do online services. I remember the first one I did back on March 22nd. It was so crazy. I think I did 4 or 5 takes on it before I got it. I was going to say good before I got it presentable, but hopefully now we've gone a little bit farther with that, but I have learned that I'm not a TV evangelist for sure, so nor do I want to be, so that's one thing. One of the questions we've had asked many times, I think, through this process is, are the online services going to continue? I'm not going to say yes, I'm not going to say no, I'm going to say probably so, at least through the summertime. We'll be trying to do the online services for those who are not able to come to church at this time, who maybe feel uncomfortable to get out among other people. So we'll continue the online services for a season. Whether we continue it all the time after September 1st, not real sure about that. But we've enjoyed the opportunity to reach more people through the online services. We ask some of your help in that as well, though, because we've talked as a staff. One of the keys to the online services is sharing it. Tyler, why don't you tell them how to do that?
Yeah, so, you know, we enjoy putting the services online for you and putting those together. And once we put them on our page, they're accessible to you, but they may not be accessible to other people who haven't seen it yet or don't follow our page. So it's really important that whenever we post something, if you enjoy it and you know that it's important to the growth of your spiritual journey, that you share it with your world and your page too. That not only includes the people that are in our church body, but maybe it's somebody else who could use a word of encouragement for that day. So it's really important to share. Even just liking it, even commenting on it, generates activity for the possibility of other people seeing it. So when you see it, view it, but also engage with us. Well, we
yes.
want you to be liking. We want you to be commenting. We just want to stay connected with you. I know it's different, but just make an attempt. Just put it out there for people to see.
Yes, yes.
I would say the amens on your comments work just as well as the amens in your pews. So
yes.
add those to your comments and let us know how you like what we say.
Just let us know that you're watching. that encourages us that we're making some sort of impact, I think. But it engages, as you engage, it encourages other people to engage. So just say watching or following or amen or something along those lines, just to let us know you're there and that you're watching it. Plus, as Tyler said, it helps other people do the same thing. Sharing it is vital. It increases our outreach. If we only the church people see this, then it's no different than a Sunday morning service here in our building. But if you share it, we broaden our outreach. We are able to reach so many more people. So please share it, comment on it, like it, do whatever you can to get the word out among other people. Any other comments?
Just that we have a Facebook page for Kids Ministry Youth, and Nestler also has a Hispanic page. So there's plenty of opportunities to share the word. So, you know, use all of us if you need to share the gospel.
We've tried to stagger our services that way you can watch all of them. They come on online at different times, so you can follow them. Mostly our main services are at our main times. They're 10:30 on Sunday morning, Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. But the youth throw things on there at different times, as well as Crystal with the Power Kids and Nestler with his Hispanic ministry. So follow all of them, like all of them, share all of them, if you would. And it just gets our message out to more people. May 17th, what will the church look like and what will you do differently? How will it impact the way you do ministry? Starting back, Nestler, or anyone else that wants to comment on that. What will we do differently as far as church goes?
I think one of the things we need to continue working on our social media as you mentioned, Pastor, we don't know what's going to happen after September, but still we need to work on online a little bit, because we have learned about Zoom and some other new things that have come and help us be in touch with our people. It's a way of keeping calling them, texting them. So I think one of the different things right now is we won't be able to go visiting in their houses a lot, but we can be in touch with the phone and a phone call or something like that.
Right. That's good. Anybody else? What do you think?
Well, it's going to be different coming through the doors, because you're not going to be able to hug. You're not going to be able to shake a hand. So I hope that we see lots of smiles. So I hope we see smiles. So I think just the atmosphere is going to be a little bit different, I think, when we come in here.
I think, you know, people are so excited to get back to church, but it's going to be so much different than the last Sunday you were here. Number one, our attendance will not be 100% when we come back, even though we'd like to see that happen. In reality, that's not going to happen. We're not going to have 100% come back in. There are some guidelines that I'll go over in just a moment concerning the attendance and who can come back and who shouldn't come back, that kind of thing. But people have different viewpoints about this, about the quarantine and COVID virus. And so we need to be respectful of different people's opinions about how we need to move forward about that. So not everybody's going to come back, and we need to respect those people who choose not to at first. So our attendance will be less, so it won't be the excitement that we normally would expect or would want, but we'll build with that. We'll build on top of that. I think I mentioned on a service not long ago that we don't want a pep rally, we want a revival. And revival can start with a remnant, so that's what we're believing God for. But we don't want a pep rally where we're just here to high-five and hug everybody. We want to see a sovereign move of God during this time. So I think that'll make services appear a little different.
I think taking that question a little differently, too, I would hope that when we come back, there's that hunger for not going back to the same way that we did things before.
Yes.
Seeking the presence of God, seeking God to move in our lives, seeking Him to move as a church that isn't the same thing just getting back to life as normal, because the reality is church shouldn't be the way that it always was. We shouldn't just be going back into or sitting in the same seat and going back to the way things were, but really seeking that different, that new move of God through our community, through our families, through our church, not just going back and thinking, I'm glad things are back to normal. Yeah. I don't really want things to get back to normal. I want to be able to move forward in what God has.
Amen.
Yep. I just wanted to add a thought on that. I know, like, just thinking about all the ways that we will physically be limited coming back. And with that whole pep rally idea, you just see so much activity and so much external things going on. But I think going off of what Emily said, there's something internally I believe is going to happen. Something when we position our hearts, that's when that change begins. And so while it may not be looking like these altars are flooded and people close together worshiping, I don't think that should detract from what can happen with the individual together as we're here with God putting a change on our hearts. So that's what I'm excited to see, how that's going to look.
Yeah. You know, we may be limited in number that can come or will be here, but we are not limited in spiritual movement. We can still have a spiritual move of God in our church during this time. I hope that gives us a new appreciation for church, for each other, and for the opportunity to come and gather and worship together. I hope it gives us that. How is the youth ministry going to change through all this?
It's a good question. So youth are probably one of the most energetic and social people in our entire body. So for them to social distance is going to be a huge challenge, and that a lot of that's going to fall on me and our leadership. And we're going to take the precautions necessary to keep our students safe when we do return. You know, we may not be playing games the same way that we used to play games. We may not be sitting in as close as proximity as we did. The hugs, the handshakes, the high fives, the hugging and all that. You know, kids are creative. They'll find a way to be social and be interactive. We just kind of have to direct them in that way. We got to kind of get their brain turning a little bit so that they don't just revert back to what they were doing before. We want to keep them safe. So the methods may change from what we're doing as far as interaction standpoint, but I'll tell you one thing. We're still going to preach the word. We're still going to worship. We're still going to learn. We're still going to pursue Christ. That's not going to change. So,
Amen. What about kids ministry? How is that going to change?
Well, one of the things is that we will stick to our policies about no fever, you can't come in. We'll be looking at those policies before we open and see where we can make sure we're taking care of infectious control and everything. But kids will wash hands, hand wash when they come in. We won't do contact games where, you know, we're sticking gummy bears on our faces or anything like that. So our games will, again, be different. We'll probably spread out a little bit more than what we normally do. We won't do small groups. But like Tyler said, we're still going to preach the message. Our prayer time might look different, but we're still going to have prayer time. And our nursery staff will meet together and make sure we come up with ways that not only protect the children, but protect our workers as well.
What about social media? What are you going to do?
We'll continue. We're going to continue our Powerhouse Online on Sundays at 1. And I'll still call kids and still do little, you know, little information pieces on Facebook for them. And I know that they're limited to their social media because of parents. So if parents will send me messages of when they're available, I will call them and visit with them or whatever I can do to connect with your kids.
Now, tell us what you're doing on Sunday mornings, because the children will be with the parents on Sunday. So what are you doing?
Yes, on Sunday mornings, during the time that we're in here worshiping together and Nestler's families are worshiping together, there will be activity bags in the back pews for the kids to come and get. So and there's like a page that has sermon notes and crossword puzzles and things that they can do during the service that will help them listen to the service but not distract you or distract anyone around you. And there's also a little game or something in there to kind of occupy them as well.
Great. We know that they're probably limited to their wanting to engage in the services, so this will help them stay busy and help parents also give them something.
I would ask you not to let them be on social media during church. This is a great time for them to get to know how to worship with in the sanctuary. So I would encourage you not to let them be on social media or on your cell phones. I know I have a 4-year-old that wants to play on my phone, but I think they can, if they can do praise and worship and do lessons in Powerhouse, then they can participate in here as well. So I encourage you to let them do the worship songs with you, make them stand up, and then also to listen. Ask them questions when they leave and find out what they heard. They may have heard something totally different than what you did.
They definitely will hear it differently. What about youth? What are you going
to
do?
We also ask our youth to sit with their families on Sunday morning as well. You know, thinking about kind of the social media Crystal was talking about, for a lot of things we're doing in youth, I don't think necessarily they all have to go away when we come back. I think keeping them engaged throughout the week and staying connected with them is going to be really important, because I do know that once we come back with youth, there will be some that still take a while to get back, and we don't want them to feel like they're left out, and we just kind of want to include them as well. So we're going to take the precautions necessary for our youth. We're also going to keep coming up with ideas and ways to keep them connected. So,
yeah. Amen. So, youth and children, be looking for social media aspects of a ministry, Instagram, those kind of things, so you can still be engaged during this time that we're not able to meet together in person. Emily, what will discipleship, since we're not doing connect groups right now and haven't been for a while, don't have Sunday school right now, what's discipleship going to look like?
Well, the good thing is discipleship is still happening and will still happen. We will still have connect groups, just not right now during this time. And we will still have classes and things where we'll learn together. It just may not be immediate. But the biggest thing I think I would encourage people is what we've talked about before is take this time to learn how to disciple your home. And if you need resources to do that, please come talk to us. We would love to give you resources to help disciple in your house, disciple your family, and do that together through personal Bible study, through personal study of the Word, with your family and personal worship. But we also want to help with that with resources and things that we can give you, knowing that we'll be back at some point to more of a formal connect groups or formal Sunday school or something like that. But really, we want to encourage you to take this time to learn to disciple your family.
Amen.
It will come back. It will go back to being able to study together. And if you want to study with other people, there are things like Zoom. There are things like Facebook groups and different things that if you've got friends that you want to study something with, to bring them alongside with you and use those resources, use those video resources to study a passage of scripture together as families. So it will come back to connect groups at some point, but definitely utilize the resources that we have right now to continue discipleship, because discipleship isn't something that stops just because the church building may not be open every single time that we're used to. Discipleship's an ongoing process.
Amen. I would just encourage you to make your home a church and be with your families, disciple them, have classes with them, lessons with them, read devotions with them, all of the things that Emily has talked about. If you need some help with that, you can surely contact Emily, Tyler, or Crystal, and Nessler, and they can help you, especially these young people. They can help you get clued in with Zoom if you want to do it with somebody else, or Facebook or Instagram or some kind of lesson that you can do with someone else. Tyler may want to do a Bible study through Zoom or whatever. Just ways that you can connect, but also ways that you can grow closer to the Lord on your own during this time. We haven't made a decision yet about a summer connect group. We're sort of walking through this in a process, in gradual motion. So we're not real sure what the summer is going to look like. And when we decide that and determine what we're going to do, we'll let you know that for sure.
I would also mention that Sister Kim does a Thursday devotion right now, so yes. That's a great way for you to be poured into and be discipled, is to watch those devotions. And it doesn't just have to stop with our devotions. You can go and search your own devotions. I know there's some big names out there that do devotions that you could watch, or right. YouTube, YouVersion also has plans that are devotions you can use as well.
The Bible app YouVersion is tremendous. It has great devotions for the family, for individuals, just whatever you need. The Bible app YouVersion, if you don't have it, you need to put it on your phone if you have the ability to do that. And if you need any help with that technical part, they can help you with this. But it's a great tool to use for family devotions and personal devotions as well, and just daily Bible reading guides as well. You know, Emily, when we come back together again, this virus has put a twist on the way we do life and the way we move around and interact with others. You go to the store and you see people wearing masks, wearing gloves. How are we going to calm people's fears as they come back to church on that Sunday morning?
I think one thing is realizing that we're not alone. We're in this together. We might be separate, but we're together at the same time. But also just we're continuing to seek God, because that's where our faith is, and putting our faith in God and not our faith in fear to hold us back. I think there's wisdom. We need to use wisdom that God gives us in situations, and, you know, not hugging, not, you know, the things like that, but really seeking faith during this time and lifting each other up. If we see someone who is struggling with fear, that's the time where we can talk to them and lift them up and bring out scriptures about combating that together. That's where we get to be the church a little bit,
yeah.
And lift each other up, spur one another on in good things, and speak to that. And that's not just something that church staff does. You know, we are the church. All of us are. That is something that every single person can do, is we encourage each other during this time not to live in fear, but to walk in wisdom and walk in faith.
Amen. You know, I've seen a lot of posts on Facebook of people that are struggling right now, struggling financially, struggling in their social aspects as well. They've been with family forever, it seems like, and just looking for other means to communicate and to get out. And I've seen there's been a gamut of emotions out there. So if you have fears or some sort of emotional issue that you're going through, don't be afraid to post it. Don't be afraid to share it or ask somebody for help. We don't want you to suffer this. It's okay not to be okay. I preached that series not too long ago. It's okay not to be okay. So don't be ashamed of it, but don't walk in fear. That's a tool of the enemy. God's not giving us a spirit of fear, but of peace, love, and of sound mind. So walk in peace and wisdom that God gives us. Well, we've gone through 8 weeks of the COVID virus, 8 weeks of quarantine, 8 weeks of all kinds of emotions. What positives have come out of this virus, this crisis? What positives have you gained through this?
I think just a general dependency more on God and trusting Him has definitely come out of this crisis for me. You know, a lot of the times, just kind of in our normal walk, even before this, I'm a planner. I like to think ahead. I like to have a date on the calendar and circle it and have this planned out. With everything that's gone on, we really haven't known when a lot of things are going to happen. It's been really hard to prepare, but also kind of make our own plans, and it's just kind of a reminder that God is in control, and He has His timeline, and He has His sovereignty that we need to lean on. And so, man, I've just been leaning on that. I can say, personally, I don't think I've read more scripture in my entire life than during this time. I can assure you that. So that's for me. I know a lot of people up here can probably attest to that too. But
Nestor, what about you?
Yeah, I heard this expression a week ago. A pastor said it. don't ever waste a crisis. Mm-hmm. Don't ever waste a crisis. What it means is that we have to learn something out of this. We have to come up with something out of this. Tyler just mentioned about reading the Bible. Many people is doing that. They're reading the Bible. They're, like we said before, they've been praying together. We also learn that there's a need in our own house, in our own homes, with our own kids to be minister. They are desperate asking to be minister from us as parents.
Yeah.
So don't ever waste this crisis and do your homework. Pursue God, seek God. I really believe that when we come back to church, it's going to be a move of God stronger than ever. Because people have been praying in their houses. They're learning how to seek God. So whenever we come back, it's going to be like an explosion of worshiping and praising the Lord all together. So we're learning out of this, and I'm glad we're in this. Sometimes we don't think it that way because nobody likes crisis.
Right.
But I think we can learn something out of this and come back together and say, oh, we have learned this, and we will probably have more testimonies about what we have learned.
What God's done. Amen. Emily, what have you learned, either about yourself or through this crisis? What positive things?
Oh, positive. Okay. I think the biggest positive is the connections with some people that just life got busy, and we didn't keep in contact as much. And just last week, I had conversations with like an old high school teacher that I used to be really close with, and some old professors that just called and just asked, you know, how I was doing and how everything was going, and really just got to connect and want to connect more in the future. So I think that's been one of the most positives is, you know, we always say, oh, you know, I'll call them when I have time, or I'll, you know, connect with this person. And if they're not in your immediate circle, sometimes it's easy to just continue to do that and push it off every single day. And so it's been neat getting to talk to people from all parts of my life and get to reconnect with them during this time, just because it's come back to memory. And some of them are at home and some of them are doing different things, and so just being able to reconnect has been really a positive.
I think for one thing for sure, family time has been awesome, has been a great positive time. We've spent time just walking and talking about things. But another thing is that we've learned, again, how to be flexible and how to be stretched by God. And, you know, I think we got so used to our routine that this little, you know, pandemic has really caused us to be stretched by God and be flexible in things. So I would say that's even though it sounds a negative that, you know, our life got switched upside down, it actually has been a positive because we let God have control of this, and we've just kind of had to step back and say, okay, you show me what to do.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Okay, well, our last question. What are some expectations of what God is going to do? What are your expectations of what God is going to do when we come back? What are you looking forward to as far as that goes?
Oh, I'm excited. I expect God to move, and not the pep rally. I expect God to move and just have a fresh outpouring of His Spirit within this place. I'm expecting healings. I'm expecting, I just expect for God to do amazing things within this church. I'm expecting for feelings, hurtful feelings, to be healed, because I think those things have been kind of washed away now. So I just expect the doors of this church to be blown off with the Spirit of God.
Amen. Anybody else?
I think I'm just expecting the, you know, we talked a lot about that there's been a renewed private time with the Lord and personal house time, but hopefully this would encourage that draw toward the corporate time. Because we're called, even in the Bible, not to neglect time with others and not to neglect that. And so I think just that excitement of renewed passion about not only seeking the Lord on our own, but corporately as well, and growing together.
I think one more thing is that we have had some phone calls, my wife and I, from new people that we don't know. We have met them. They have met us actually through the social media, and they've been asking about the Hispanic ministry, and I hope we'll have more people coming. I know many people will be afraid to gather in a church, but some others are asking,
where
is this ministry? What are we doing? So one of our expectations is to have more people probably in our services, new people.
Amen. Amen.
I definitely expect relationships with God to just be more intimate than ever before, to go deeper in a way that we wouldn't expect. I talked about this a little before, just the external evidence of, you know, the pep rally mindset or anything. It's sometimes easier than the deep-rooted relationship that can take place, and I think that's going to happen. And I may be jumping the gun by saying this, but I think God's going to prepare some people to go out and to do ministry work in these early stages that we come back. The tendency a lot of the times is for us to think, man, I can't wait to see what God does for me when I come back to church. But that may be God's preparation for you to go out afterwards, when some of these restrictions are let down, when the world may be coming back to normal. That's just one of my expectations.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. Well, no doubt we're all excited about coming back together again. We're all looking forward to it. We're hungry to see each other. We're also, I think, hungry spiritually to see a move of God. And let's not miss this crisis. Let's not miss this moment. I've been thinking about relationships throughout all this time. You know, one thing we've lost is that relationship with one another through this. And I pray that when we come back that we'll be anxious to renew those relationships, but even deepen those relationships with one another. Like I said earlier, we've got a letter coming out this week. You should be getting it tomorrow or the next day. And be looking for it. It'll explain some of the guidelines that we need to adhere to as we regather. Let me go over just a few of those, a few bullet points real quick, like regarding our reopening. We will only do Sunday morning service only. Sunday morning only. That's our 10:30 service. Our church here and also the Puerta de Esperanza, the Hispanic ministry, will only be doing Sunday morning worship only. There will be no Sunday school or no evening services at this time. There will also be no Power Kids children's ministry and no nursery. So you're probably wondering, well, what am I going to do with my kids? They're going to be rowdy. They're going to be anxious. They're going to be moving from place to place. Well, Pastor Crystal has got something set up for the children's age for them to do. And by all means, I understand you may have a baby that may be a little fussy, but we'll overlook that, and it won't be a big deal for us. You just let them be fussy. I'll just take it as an amen, and we'll just keep moving right across. But don't let that deter you from coming. Again, Crystal will have activities for the children. Youth are able to listen and engage in the services, so they'll be fine. There'll be no Wednesday night services as well, no Wednesday activities at all. Pastor Crystal and Pastor Tyler will, again, be engaging with our youth and our children throughout the week and maybe even on Wednesday night to take that place. But at this time, there will be no midweek services for the American church or the Hispanic ministry. No Wednesday night activities whatsoever. Let me go back on Sunday morning. We're asking, I think we said it earlier, but we're asking our families to sit together. So youth won't be sitting up front like they normally do, but they'll be sitting with their families, their parents. You'll have your children with you as well. So we're asking families to sit together. There will also be no meet and greet. We're Pentecostals. We love to hug and shake hands and all those kinds of things. But we're asking right now that you refrain from doing that. A simple smile, a wave, or an air high five will work great. So just give an air five out there, and we'll appreciate that very much. There'll be no offering bags passed. There'll be no bulletins handing out. We're trying to eliminate any type of point of contact. So we have purchased boxes to put your offerings in. So no offering bags passed from back and forth. We know that you've been in isolation, it seems like, and locked down in prison for the last 6 or 8 weeks. But we ask that you avoid gathering in the foyer, the hallways, or the entrances. When we come into church and when we dismiss, we ask that you come immediately when you arrive and sit down. And when you dismiss, we ask that you leave immediately the building. And again, no gatherings together, no gathering in the foyer. We love to gather in the foyer and talk and love and just reminisce a little bit. And that'll be really an important part of our first two or three gatherings together. But we ask that you try to refrain from doing that. Don't gather in the foyer. Don't gather in the church building itself. Don't gather in the entrances or any of those kinds of things. And we'd appreciate that so very much. Again, after you read the letter, if you have any questions, feel free to contact our offices here, and we'll try to answer those questions the best we can. When you come in on Sunday, May 17th, you're going to walk into our building, and you're going to say, "What's happened to my church since I've been gone? What have they done?" Well, things will be a little bit different than when you first come in, when you're used to. We are going to be removing every other pew, and we're going to be doing that for two reasons. In fact, if you can help us this week, anytime during the week, this week, we need your help. We have to unscrew the pews, unbolt them, and then pick them up and remove them from the building. We'll be doing that for two reasons. One, because of the virus. It will help us to maintain social distancing. And I know everybody is sick and tired of that word, social distancing. We're ready to be social. But to help us maintain social distancing, we will remove every other pew that will put 6 feet between each pew. And so that will be one reason we're doing it, for this social distancing aspect. But also, our church is beginning our phase of remodeling. And it will help us to prepare for the remodel. Eventually, the pews will have to come out anyway. So we're going to go ahead and remove half of the pews right now. Again, if you can help us, we'll put something on Facebook. But if you can help us, we'll work on a Sunday, on a night this week, on a Thursday night or a Wednesday night or whatever. We'll get together and put it on there. But we need your help. We can't do it ourselves, the staff. And we need your help to move these pews into another location. So we'll be looking for that, a post on social media. And I hope you'll agree with all that. I hope it worked fine for you. You know, we're all anxious to get back together again. But we want to do it, the staff and I want to do it in a safe way. We want to do it in a safe way. And we want to do it also as a means to support our community and our statewide leaders, the leadership that they've given us through this process. We've been in meetings, all of us have been in meetings throughout this process about how we're going to move forward. And the one thing that comes out of every meeting is we want to do it safely. We want to do it safely. So just be expecting us to have some things differently in our church. We mentioned it earlier, I think, that let's not return to normal services. One thing Kim and I have talked a lot about during this is we don't want things to return like they were. Let's not just go back to normal services. Let's come back with a new heart, a new passion, and a new vision. A desire to see our church change, but a desire to see our church impact our community as well. And we, as a staff, have been praying and believing God. We think that God is going to do amazing things through this crisis. We're not going to let this crisis dictate our lives, but we're going to let this crisis change our future. And we believe that God is going to do some great things. So be praying for that. Be praying and joining us and believing God for some miracles to happen. Worship is going to be outstanding. I can't wait to worship with you again. And I can't wait to preach to you and share God's word. But it's going to be great to get back together again. But more than anything, it's going to be great to see a move of God in our church. So be praying for that. One last reminder. I want to remind you to join us tomorrow night, Thursday, for our Park and Pray here at 7 o'clock at the church. We'll have some cones set out in places allowing you to park in different locations, and we'll have some help out there. Pastor Tyler, maybe Nestor and myself will help direct the traffic, and we want you to remain in your car to ensure social distancing. And we want you to just join us in prayer at 7 o'clock. If you'll be here at 7, you can leave whenever you feel ready to leave. But let's all make one appointment to be here at 7 o'clock sharp. And then we'll park and we'll pray for a while. And then you can be dismissed at your leisure. But make sure you join us Thursday night, 7 o'clock, for Park and Pray. Once again, I want to tell you how much we love you. We miss you. And we're looking forward to our time together again. Again, May 17th. May 17th, guys, we're coming back to church. May 17th, 10:30. We look forward to seeing you. God bless you. Have a great week. We love you.